sorrow, but his name was changed. Paul was a son, but his name was changed. Jacob was a planter, but became Israel. The Lord my God will do the same to your destiny.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
And the love of God will roll every mountain away.
Amen.
Something is happening to me tonight. I said to me tonight. I pray the power of God in his love will reach everyone tonight in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for our Bible study. Thank you for your good people, gracious people, loving people, and people who are ready to learn. Well, thank you for our workers, for our members, for our invitees, and everyone. We're asking the Lord tonight, you open the pages of the scriptures to everyone tonight in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Minister to every heart.
Amen.
Turn everyone around.
Amen.
And let your goodness be upon everyone tonight in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Keep us in your love.
Amen.
In Jesus' mighty name we pray.
Amen.
God bless you. You can be seated. We're coming to John chapter 14. In John chapter 14 tonight, we're looking at it from verse 15 all through to verse 26. John chapter 14, verse 15. If you love me, keep my commandments, and I will pray the Father, and he will send, he will give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him, but ye know him. For he dwelleth with you, and shall be in you. Somebody said amen.
Amen.
In verse 21, it says, he that has my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me. And he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father. And I will love him and will manifest myself unto him. Verse 26, for the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things. And bring all things to your remembrance, whatsoever I have said unto you. Tonight, as we look at those verses of scripture, from John chapter 14, verses 15 through to verse 26, we're looking at the promise of the Comforter for obedient disciples. The promise of the Comforter for obedient disciples. You understand that at this time, Jesus Christ was rounding up, winding up his ministry on earth. And he collected his disciples together, and they were with him. And he was talking to them of these final important instructions. Before he'll be crucified, before he'll go to Calvary, before he will die for us, before he will die for everyone that will believe on his name. And because of that, was giving them some important instructions and revealing to them things they didn't know even until this time. But as he said, he was going away, departing from them. He was leaving this world to go to the great beyond, to go back to heaven, to go back to his Father. The disciples were sorrowful because Jesus had told them he was departing from them. He was leaving the world for heaven. And what could they do now? Where would they be? How would they be sustained? They thought, without his physical presence of them, how are we going to get healing? How do we get sustained? How do we get encouraged? How do we get taught? How will we have all the blessings we have been having all these 3.5 years with the Lord Jesus Christ? But now he is going. Because of that, that's why they were unhappy. They were sad. They were sorrowful. It pained them. That's why Jesus began to tell them, look at verse 16 now, I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever. You see, that solves the problem. He said, I will pray to the Father. I will demand of the Father. I will ask the Father. He will give you another comforter. That word, another, in Greek, has two shades of meanings. Number one, it could be another of a different kind. It's like, you know, you have something, and then you say, give me another different from this one. I don't want this one. Give me another. You can use the word another in that sense. But you can also use the word another in another sense. Another of the same kind. That is, this is so good. I need another one. But not another one different. Another of the same kind. And that's the word Jesus used for them. He said, I have been with you and you think there is a great loss because I'm going. But no, I'm going to send another of the same kind, another of the same grace, another of the same love, another of the same helping hand, the paraclete. It will be with you. In fact, he calls him the comforter. He says, I'm going to send another one like myself. Another one, another deity, another one with supreme power, another one with divinity, but he'll be another comforter, capital C, that he may abide with you. Now, I mean, what if after 3.5 years also that another comforter that is coming will leave us? He says, no, this one will abide forever. And the comforter comes to your life tonight and is going to abide with you forever in Jesus' name. And now, he also says in verse 17, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive. He says, those who are going to receive this, they're going to have something special. You are having something that the people out there will not have. That the people of the world will not have. No matter what they have, no matter what strength they have, what knowledge they have, what riches they have, what prosperity they have, what position they have, if they're in the world, you're going to get something that the world cannot receive. Then it says, why can they not receive? Look at verse 17, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him, but ye know him, you'll know him more. For he abideth with you and shall be in you. Abideth with you. There's some people that have doubts about the disciples of Lord Jesus Christ. All that time Jesus was with them, were they saved? Some people are asking. Were they having a different kind of disposition, different kind of life from the people of the world? Jesus said, yes, they are saved. How do we know they are saved? Look at that. He dwelleth with you. He's with you now. You have partnership with him. You have connection with him because you are saved. And the Spirit of God, the Holy Ghost, bears witness with your heart that you are a child of God. And to show that they were saved and that the Spirit of God was abiding with them. Look at what it says now in verse, I'm reading chapter 15. In chapter 15, verse 18. If the world hates you, ye know that it hated me before it hated you. If ye were of the world would love its own. But because ye are not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hateth you. Were they saved? I said, were they saved? Yes, because he said, I have chosen you out of the world. Look at chapter 17. In chapter 17, I'm reading from verse 14. I have given them thy word, and the world has hated them because they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. Let there be no doubt in your mind. They were saved. They were children of God. They were followers of Christ. They were disciples. And Jesus said, they were not of the world, even as I'm not of the world. Look at verse 16. They are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. In fact, he told, 70 of those disciples in Luke chapter 10. I'm looking at Luke chapter 10. I'm reading here from verse 20. Luke chapter 10, and we're looking at verse 20. It says, notwithstanding in this, rejoice not that the spirits are subject unto you, but rather rejoice because, tell me, your names are written in heaven. That shows that they were saved. These were children of God. These were disciples of Christ. And now he was promising them something. He was promising the comforter for obedient disciples. Obedient disciples. The Holy Ghost himself was already with them. In them it will be, beside them it will be, for them it will be, and that will be forever. They were only to keep and to obey the commandments of the Lord, and he will manifest himself unto them, reveal himself unto them in a greater measure, in a broader measure, in a higher measure, in a deeper measure. And I pray that deeper, higher, greater experience of the Holy Ghost will be yours from tonight in Jesus' name. Amen. The topic again, the promise of the comforter for obedient disciples. 3 points we're going to look at. Number one, our consecration and submission to his teaching. Our consecration and submission to his teaching. Point number two, the comforter, the spirit of truth. The comforter, the spirit of truth. Number three, the characterization of the spirit as teacher. The characterization of the spirit as teacher. We're coming to number one, our consecration and submission to his teaching. You see, the Lord Jesus Christ expected that if they were followers of him, they would learn of him. If they were followers of him, they will really follow him. If they were really followers of him, they were disciples, he knew that they will receive him, totally receive him, receive his word, receive his commandment and everything he had told them. Because if they loved, you see, there are people that will think they manifest their loves by crying, by tears. And that's what Jesus was telling them. Jesus said, you're showing that you love me, but the way you are demonstrating that love is that you're sorrowful. Hey, it's going away. And he's going to the Father. He said, if you love me, you will rejoice because I said, I'm going to the Father. But the kind of love that is selfish, that will not want me to live here and go to my heavenly Father and go to my glory in heaven, that kind of love that is crying and sorrowful, that, we're going to miss you. He said, I want the demonstration of love in another way. Look at what he said in John chapter 14, verse 15. He said, if ye love me, keep my commandments, not by tears, not by crying, not by expressing sorrow. You love me, you will show that love by obeying me and keeping my commandments. Look at verse 21. He that has my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me. It is not the people that are just professing, we love you, don't go. We love you, we're crying. We love you, we're sorrowful. We love you. See our tears. Our tears show that we love you. Said, no, no. We don't measure love like that. Heaven doesn't measure love like that. It says, he that has my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me. And he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father. And I will love him too, and I will manifest myself unto him. It says when you love him like that and you're keeping his word, he'll reveal himself more and more unto you. Every day and every step, as you love him and love him and love him, there's manifestation of his grace, of his goodness, of his glory, manifestation of his power in your life. He that loveth me keepeth my commandments, and I will manifest myself unto him. Look at verse 22. Judas says unto him, this is not Iscariot, another Judas. It says, Lord, how is it that thou wilt manifest thyself unto us and not unto the world? How is it to reveal yourself to us and not to the world? Have you noticed? Jesus died according to what he had said and according to all the prophecies of the Old Testament. He was buried. And then he rose again the third day. Do you know that when he rose the third day, what would have thought? Anybody would have thought, go and show those Pharisees you have risen from the dead. He never showed himself to those Pharisees, to those Sadducees, and to the people of the world, and to those sinners, and to those gainsayers after he rose from the dead. But the angel said, he's not here. Why are you looking for the living among the dead? Go tell his disciples and meet him in Galilee. And why? While the doors were shut, Jesus appeared unto them, unto his own disciples, and he said, peace be unto you. And then Thomas was not there. When Thomas was there the following week, he came again and revealed himself unto his own disciples. He manifested himself to the people that loved him and not to the people of the world. Look at verse 23. It says, Jesus answered and said unto him, if a man love me, he will keep my words. You see the emphasis of Jesus Christ. He wanted to make us understand that love is something practical. Some love is something visible. Love is something remarkable. And that love is manifested by keeping his word. And my Father will love him, and we will come unto him and make our abode with him. Look up here for a moment. You know, if somebody is always neglecting you, disregarding you, and pushing you off, and negating your word, you don't want to stay with such people. You don't want to abide with such people. But Jesus said, if you're keeping my word, you show that you love me. You love me, my Father will love you. I will love you. Not only that, we will come and make our habitation, our abode with you. If you want him to be with you, if you want him to keep on helping you, as a partner, as the one that is resident in you and resident with you every time, all you need to do is love him and keep his commandments. His presence will never leave you in Jesus' name. And then he tells us in verse 24, he that loveth me not keepeth not my sayings. It says the man may be religious, the woman be religious, but you know, they never obey the Lord. They're not keeping the commandments of the Lord. They keep their own, you know, their own will, and they're so strong-minded. This is what I'm going to do. And then they come every Sunday, every Lord's Day. Lord, I love you. How wonderful you are. How great you are. And how majestic you are. And then they give all these titles and all these appellations to Jesus Christ. He says, no, he doesn't love me. He just talks. It's only the talk of the mouth. It says if you're really born again, it says if you're really a child of God and you want to show that you love me, there's only one mark, there's only one evidence, there's only one way. You will be obedient to my word. He that loveth me not keepeth not my sayings, and the word which ye hear is not mine but the Father's which sent me. These things have I spoken unto you, be yet present with you. And look at John chapter 15, a consecration. If you're a real child of God, and if you want to show that you really love God, the mark, the evidence is that you're obedient unto his word. You commit yourself, you consecrate yourself, and you totally surrender yourself unto the Lord. You surrender your will, you surrender your mind, you surrender your soul, everything, and then you pledge your life in obedience obedience to the Lord. You pledge your willingness to really obey the Lord. You pledge everything you've got with all your soul, all your mind, that you're going to be obedient to the Lord, because you know that's the way heaven recognizes love. That's the way Jesus recognizes love. That's the way the Heavenly Father recognizes love, that you're obedient and keeping to the commandment of the Lord. John chapter 15, I'm reading from verse 10. It says in John 15, 10, if ye keep my commandments, ye shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandment and abide in his love. You know, he repeats that over and over for you to understand that if there's no obedience in your life, that if there's no keeping of the commandments of God in your life, if there is no dedication to following the word of God in your life, and if you're not checking your life, every area of your life, every detail of your life, and you align with your life with the word of God, it says there's no love there. But the love that Christ is expecting, and the love that was manifested for the child of God and for the obedient disciple, is that look at the word of God, I'm following. Look at the word of God, I'm living by that word of God. Look at the word of God, I'm obedient to that word of God. Look at verse 11 there. That is John chapter 15, verse 11. It says in verse 11, these things have I spoken unto you, that my joy might remain in you, and that your joy might be full. Are you joyful? The Lord will increase that joy. And that joy will be full in Jesus' name. Look at verse 12. This is my commandment, that ye love one another. As I have loved you, greater love as no man than this, that a man should lay down his life for his friends. Ye are my friends if, tell me. Ye are my friends if ye do whatsoever I command you. You see, that is the measure of the love of God. You say, I'm in fellowship with God. Are you obedient? You say, I'm a child of God. Are you obedient? You say, I love the Lord. I love Jesus as my Savior. I love Jesus as my healer. I love Jesus as my sanctifier. It is not the talk of mouth. It is how you're obedient to the word of the Lord. And these commandments that he said, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. Look at those. Look at what he said about those commandments in Matthew chapter 24 and verse 35. Matthew chapter 24, verse 35. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall not pass away. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my commandments shall not pass away. My requirement shall not pass away. My demand shall not pass away. My will shall not pass away. The commandments I've given unto my disciples, and if you're a disciple of the Lord, the commandments I've given shall not pass away. You will not say, well, that's that time, that's that period, those are those early disciples of the Lord, and they could obey the Lord, but look at me, I'm now in this, you know, generation after them. How could I be obedient to the word of the Lord? If you love the Lord, if you have the same salvation that they had, if you had the same love and the same belief that they had, if you have the same commitment that those disciples had, you will be obedient to the word of the Lord. In fact, it tells us in Matthew chapter 28, and I'm reading from verse 19, Matthew chapter 28, verse 19. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. Teaching them, see that? Teaching them everything he had taught. Everything he had laid down for them, every commandment he had given them, is not just for them. It's not just for those early disciples, those early apostles, but it's for all the disciples, all the followers, all the believers, all the children of God until the end of the world. Look at verse 20, teaching them to observe how many things? Tell me out aloud. All things whatsoever I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. And the church said, amen. Amen. It's telling us that the commandments of God are still for today. The commandments of the Lord, they live, they go on, because Jesus Christ said the same yesterday and today and forever. And what he said before, that's what he's still saying now. And he says he wants all those commandments. The commandments of Jesus, they are not redundant. They are not old-fashioned. They are not archaic. They are not something to be forgotten. They are not something to push behind us. We're not looking for any other new thing. Jesus is the same every time. And God is the same every time. And his commandments are the same every time. He commanded repentance, still necessary. He commanded restitution, still necessary. He commanded righteousness, still necessary. He commanded purity of heart, still necessary. He commanded water baptism, still necessary. He commanded the Lord's Supper, still necessary. He commanded one man and one wife until death do them part. It is still necessary. He commanded that you go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. It's still necessary. He commanded that you occupy until I come. Still necessary. And he says that, look at my commandments. If you say you love me, where is your evidence that you love me and that you're obedient to the commandments I have given? We're going to follow the word of God. We're going to be obedient to the word of God. And it says, until the end of the age, until the end of the world, in Colossians chapter 3. Colossians chapter 3, I'm reading from verse 16. It says, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom. Let the commandments of Christ dwell in you. Let the requirement of Christ dwell in you. Let the demand of Christ dwell in you. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. And then it says, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. And whatsoever ye do, it should be in obedience to the commandments of the Lord. Whatsoever ye say, it should be in obedience to the commandment of the Lord. Wherever ye go, it should be in obedience to the commandment of the Lord. However you dress, it's going to be in accordance to the word of God. However you witness is going to be in accordance to the word of God. What you sell, what you buy, what you take, what you don't take, what you drink, what you eat. It says, whatsoever ye do, do all do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks unto God and the Father by him. You see, the people who are not born again, the people who are not real Christians, the people who are not Bible Christians, they go to church on Sunday and they think that the word of God is for Sunday. The word of God is for, you know, that time of worship. On Monday they go to their places of work and look at their character, look at the bribery, look at the corruption, look at the stealing, and look at the cheating, look at the lying. They go to the market, they don't take the word of God to the market, they don't take the word of God to their family, they don't take the word of God anywhere with them. They just leave it on Sunday, and then next Sunday they come back again. Here we come again, we want to worship the Lord, I want to hear the word of God, but the word has no impact, has no power on them. They do not love the Lord because they reject the word of the Lord. But the Lord is saying that if you love him, you remain with that word, abide with that word, be obedient to that word every time, anytime, everywhere, anywhere, every period of your life. We're looking at 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1, I'm reading here from verse 14. 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 14, as obedient children, what kind of children am I? What kind of children are you? What kind of servants are you? What kind of believer are you? Obedient children. You know, if you cannot obey the word of the Lord, that means you don't have grace. That means you are not saved. That means you are not born again. If you are born again, you will be an obedient child of God. If we are born again, if we have tasted that the Lord is good, we'll be obedient children of God. As obedient children, not fashioning yourselves according to the former laws in your ignorance. But as he which has called you is holy, so be ye holy. Somebody there, so be ye holy, help me. So be ye holy, help me. So be ye holy. In how many things? in all manner of conversation. You see, there are people who they are kind of sifting. They say, okay, in this area, I'll be holy. In this area, I'll be holy. In that other area, I'll be holy. But he wants you to be holy in all manner of conversation. That is, in your character. That is, in your behavior. That is, in your lifestyle. Anywhere you find yourself, you're on the road, in a taxi, be holy in that taxi. You're in the bus, be holy in that bus. You are at, in a marketplace, be holy in that place. You are writing exam, remain holy while you're writing exam. You are selling the market, remain holy every time. Between you, husband and wife, be holy every time. Not that, okay, this is, husband and wife or something, and then you get angry and you are fighting and there's strife. It says that in every situation you find yourself, the commandment of the Lord is, except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees, ye shall in no wise enter into the kingdom of heaven. And so if you want to enter the kingdom of heaven, and you want to show, and you want to prove, and you want to have the evidence that you belong to him, you are holy in all manner of conversation at all times. Look at verse 16 there. Because it is written, because it is written, because it is written, because it is written, be holy for I am holy. There are people that holiness, say, oh, deeper life doctrine. That, if you go to deeper life, the only thing you hear, be ye holy because you are in deeper life. Be ye holy, tell me. For I am holy. That was written before deeper life, a church, a denomination, or deeper Christian life ministry began many years ago. That God said, the reason why he wants you to be holy is not because of your church name. It's not because of your church denomination. It's not because you're in deeper life here, or you are in another local church over there. It says because the nature of God is holy, because heaven is holy, because the angels are holy, and because all the streets they are holy, and because his word is holy, the Holy Bible, and because everything about God is holy, and you say you are a child of God, as obedient children, not fashioning yourselves according to your former laws in your ignorance, but as he which has called you holy, so be ye holy. For it says, be ye holy, for I am holy. If we're children of God and we want to prove that we love God, we'll follow the word of God. We'll be obedient to the word of God. Look at 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2. I'm reading here from verse 3. 1 John chapter 2 verse 3. Hereby know we that we know him if we keep his commandments. You see that? This is the evidence that we know him. This is the evidence that we are born again. This is the evidence we are children of God and disciples of Christ. It says, hereby do we know that we know him. Sometimes in some of our meetings, give chance for testimony. And then you find this person coming up, praise the Lord, I am a child of God. Praise the Lord, I want you to hear my testimony now. I was here, I was there, and this happened, and that happened, and then I came out of that situation. Don't you see? Praise the Lord, I'm a child of God. And the wife is listening, and the wife said, my husband, look at my husband giving testimony, I'm a child of God. I know the way he fights at home. I know the way he's angry all the time at home. I know he's rebelling. I even know that he's stealing from the place of work where he is. That's not being a child of God. If you want to show you're a child of God, it's not the empty testimony, it's not the empty profession. Praise the Lord, I'm a child of God. Let's see it by your life. Let's see it by obedience to the word of God. Hereby know we that we know him if we keep his commandments. In verse 4, he that saith I know him and keepeth not his commandments is a liar. He that says I know him, I'm born again, I'm a child of God, I'm going to deeper life, I'm going to richer life, I'm going to higher life. He that says he knows God in a high way, in a deep way, in a broad sense, and yet he's not keeping the commandment of God is a liar, and the truth is not in him. Whosoever keepeth his word, look at this, Whosoever keepeth his word, in him verily is the love of God perfected. Hereby know we that we are in him. That's the evidence that we know the Lord. That's the evidence we're children of God. 1 John chapter 5, I'm reading from verse 2. It says, by this we know that we love the children of God when we love God and keep his commandments. You see that? You need to mark that in your Bible. You need to measure that with your life. You need to align that with your life. It says, this is the love. Look at verse 3. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments. And his commandments are not grievous. His commandments are not grievous. In fact, that's what the Lord had said, even from Old Testament times. If you look at Deuteronomy chapter 4, Deuteronomy chapter 4, I'm reading here from verse 2. Deuteronomy chapter 4, looking at verse 2, it says, ye shall not add unto the word which I command you, neither shall ye diminish aught from it, that ye may keep the commandments of the Lord your God, which I command you. It says, you will not add. See, there are people, they try to add tradition to the word of God. And that's what made the Pharisees not to be born again. That's what made those religious people, Sadducees, not to know the Lord, because they added their tradition. Do you know there are some people, they come to our church here, the Palai Bible Church, but they have been in another church before, a candle burning church. They have been in some other churches before, and it's an incense burning church. They have been in another church before, it's a historic church, Orthodox church, and there were some practices they did over there that you don't find in the Bible. And even though they say they are here now, I'm born again, they're still adding those denominational traditions to the word of God they are hearing. And the Lord is saying, you're not following him, you're following the tradition of that old religious society where you were before. And then it says, you will not take away, you'll obey the totality of the word of God. If you love God, you're not going to say, I don't like that one. I accept faith, because by faith you can overcome every challenge and every difficulty. Above all, taking the shield of faith, you'll be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. Every time the pastor talks about faith, I pay attention. I'm all heart, I'm all ears, and I'm looking at everything, because faith is the key. But now, when you talk about repentance, that one, I don't understand that one. Restitution, that one, I don't like that one. Everything you have stolen, everything you have taken, if you say you are born again, or you bring your gift to the altar, and you remember that your brother has aught against you, leave your gift there at the altar, and go and reconcile with your brother. And Zacchaeus said, Lord, half of my good I give unto the poor. And if I've taken anything from any man by force, accusation, I restore him fourfold. The Lord Jesus Christ wants us to make right our lives, and he wants us to make restitution where you have defrauded other people, you have lied to other people, you have cheated other people, or you've done something wrong, needs to be corrected. And the Lord said, you will not add tradition to his word, and you will not take away anything from the word of God that you say, well, I don't like that. Look at that again. Deuteronomy chapter 4, I'm reading from verse 2, ye shall not add unto the word which I command you, neither shall ye diminish aught from it, that ye may keep the commandments of the Lord your God, which I command you. I pray we'll be obedient. I said, I pray you'll be obedient. Deuteronomy chapter 30, I'm reading from verse 6. Deuteronomy chapter 30, looking at verse 6. And the Lord thy God will circumcise thine heart and the heart of thy seed to love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul, that thou mayest live. You see that? He emphasizes love there. Look at verse 8. Thou shalt return and obey the voice of the Lord and do all his commandments which I command thee this day. It says in verse 6, it circumcises your heart, it purges your heart, He purifies your heart. He sanctifies you. And then he tells us, you do the commandments of God. As a result of that, you obey the commandments of God. As a result of that, in fact, when you do the commandment of God, you obey the commandments of God, you do it heartily. You do it cheerfully. You do it promptly. It's not like you are still waiting. What if the rapture happens before you get ready? Say, well, I'm not ready now. I'll think about all of a sudden the trumpet sounds, all of a sudden the dead are raised, all of a sudden those of us which are alive were caught up together to be with the Lord in the air. And there's something pulling you down, there's something pulling you back, because you are not urgent, you are not prompt, you are not quick with your restitution, you are not quick with your obedience to the word of the Lord. It tells us in Psalm 119 verse 60. Open your Bible. You want to mark this, your Bible. Psalm 119, I'm reading from verse 60. I make haste and delay not to keep thy commandments. That's love. That's love. That's the evidence that you love God. You're not dragging your feet. You're not pulling back. You're not slowing down. But you love the Lord and you make haste. You delay not to keep the commandments of the Lord. It tells us that if we're not obeying those commandments, if we're not keeping the commandments of God, it means that we don't really love Him. We're back to John chapter 14. John chapter 14, it tells us, if we love Him, we're going to keep His word. If we don't keep His word, it's an evidence we don't really love Him. It tells us in John chapter 14, verse 24, He that loveth me not, keepeth not my sayings, and the word which ye hear is not mine, but the Father's which sent me. Professing to love Him and not obeying Him, professing to love Him and not keeping His commandments, makes us liars. Those who say they love Christ and reject His doctrine, you see, that doctrine, one man, one wife, that one, I don't know what I want to do with that. Because I wouldn't have tried that woman, I want another one. After all, so and so are the 2-3 wives. Why can't I? The Lord Jesus said that the word of God is very clear. He that made them at the beginning made them male and female, one man, one woman, and the two, not three, shall be one flesh. It says what God has joined together, therefore, let no man put asunder. But he that says, I love God, I love Christ, and rejects His doctrine, that's not of God. He that says, I love the Lord, and resists His lordship. His lordship, that the Lord will not have control over him. The Lord will not have authority over him. He says, yes, Lord, you are my Savior, but I'll go my way. You are my Savior, but I'll do my own will. You are my Savior, but you'll not be a Lord over me. He that says he loves God and then resists the lordship of Christ is not of God. He that says, I love God and disregards His commandments. He knows the commandments are there. He just disregards them. He just doesn't want to do anything with those commandments. He that says he loves God and he disobeys His word, disobeys the word of the Lord. Here is the word of the Lord. Love one another as I have loved you. Whatsoever you want others to do to you, do ye even so unto them. But this man says he loves God. This man says he's a church man. This woman says she's a church woman and disobeys the word of God. That's not Christianity. That says I love God and yet neglects His ordinance. Neglects His ordinance. What's the ordinance? If you believe and you are baptized, you'll be saved. It says I've been baptized as an infant before you repented. Now you say you have repented. The ordinance of the Lord is you believe and you are baptized. Or ye that neglects the ordinance of the Lord's Supper. The Lord said, do this in remembrance of me. Every time there's going to be a Lord's Supper, it says, I don't know whether I'm qualified or not. And it's always running away from the Lord's Supper. He that says he loves the Lord and neglects His ordinance, the man says, I love the Lord and despises His these messengers, the messengers of the Lord that he has sent to us, that he's sending to us, reading the word of God to us, preaching the word of God to us, declaring the truths of the word of God to us. He despises the messengers of the Lord. Those are not children of God. He that says, I love God, and he opposes the will of God, he opposes his will. This is the will of God. Walk ye here, and then you'll find rest for your soul, but they will not. He that says, I love God, and yet avoids a standard, the standard of the word of God, and that standard that is to be for us in anything we do, whether you eat or you drink, whether you marry or you're doing wedding, whether you're doing burial, whether you are whatever celebrating, whatever it is, you keep to the word of God. But he says, I love God, and yet he avoids the standard of Christ. He that says, I love God, and he abandons his work. He abandons his work. I love God. He been saying that for 10 years. He's been a member of the church for 10 years, but going into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. The commandment of the Lord he avoids, and the commandment of the Lord he abandons. He that says, I love God, and he negates his orders. The order. Here is what to do. And he tells us, like our Savior, the captain of our salvation. And yet this woman would say, I love God, and he negates his orders. He that says, I love God, and he discourages obedience. Other people want to run. He's discouraging them. Other people want to obey. He's discouraging them. Other people want to make restitution. He's discouraging them. Other people want to be obedient to the word of God, to the letter, in every detail. But this woman, he says, I love God too, and he discourages obedience. All those people are deluded. All those people are deceiving themselves. They have no abiding relationship with Christ. If we love God, we are going to keep the word of God. I said, if you love God, you'll keep the word of God. Look at Second Corinthians chapter 5. I'm reading from verse 14. Second Corinthians chapter 5. I'm reading here from verse 14. For the love of God constraineth us. The love of Christ constraineth us, because we thus judge that if one died for all, then we're all dead. You're dead to sin. You're dead to society. You're dead to the world. And you're dead to that Adamic nature, because Christ died for you. And so you died to everything that is evil. And he died for all, that they which live should not live henceforth unto themselves, but unto him which died for them and rose again. I pray that this evidence of being a child of God will be in your life, in Jesus' name. We come to point number two now. The Comforter, the Spirit of Truth. The Comforter, the Spirit of Truth. We're coming to John chapter 14. John chapter 14. I'm reading here from verse 16. John chapter 14. And I'm reading from verse 16. Here in verse 16 it says, and I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another Comforter, that he may abide with you forever. He's saying that when he says the Holy Spirit, you know, he's saying I will. It's not giving them right there. It's making a promise that I'm going to send the Comforter unto you. It tells us in verse 17, even the Spirit of Truth, whom the world cannot receive. You see, sinners cannot receive the Holy Spirit. You see, the people who have not repented, the people who have not been converted, the people who are not children of God, they cannot come and say, Holy Ghost come, Holy Ghost come, Holy Ghost come. No, it doesn't come that way. He is holy, and he wants the heart into which is coming to be cleansed, to be forgiven, to be pardoned. He wants everything swept clean. He wants that ground to be holy. He wants the habitation to be holy. He wants the heart to be holy before he will come in. Because the Holy Spirit, even the Spirit of Truth, where there is error, where there is false doctrine, and where there's duplicity, where there's hypocrisy, where there's pride, where there's sin, he does not want to come there. He's the spirit of truth, not the spirit of error. It's the spirit of truth, it's not the spirit of a falsehood. It says, even the spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him, but ye know him, for he dwelleth with you and shall be in you. Give me a good amen. Amen. Look at verse 18. Look at verse 18. I will not leave you comfortless. I will come unto you. It says, when the Holy Ghost comes, just like I'm coming, because it's another comforter just like myself. Another comforter just like myself. Yet a little while, verse 19, and the world seeth me no more, but ye shall see me. You will see him. Because I live, he shall live also. At that day, he shall know that I am in the Father, and ye in me, and I in you. The Lord Jesus is talking about the Holy Spirit. Is the Spirit of God. This Holy Spirit is the Spirit of Christ. The Holy Spirit is the Spirit of holiness. The Holy Spirit is the Spirit of life. The Holy Spirit is the Spirit of wisdom. The Holy Spirit is the Spirit of comfort and is the Spirit of truth. And comfort will come to your life in Jesus' name. And why is he sending the Holy Spirit? And why do you need the Holy Spirit? That Holy Spirit, when he comes, he comforts, he counsels, he creates. And if you want the comfort of the Lord, this is what you need. The Holy Ghost comes, you're saved, you're sanctified, you're filled with the Holy Ghost, and then there'll be comfort, there'll be counsel, and there'll be creation, recreation. He will turn your life around. You'll be totally renewed in Jesus' name. He assures, he appoints, he anoints. That Holy Ghost is the one that gives us assurance, bearing witness with our heart that we are the children of God. And then he appoints, separate unto me Barnabas and Saul for the work which I've appointed for them. He anoints. The anointing that breaks the yoke comes through the Holy Spirit, and that anointing will come upon you in Jesus' name. Not only that, the Holy Spirit regenerates, renews, and reveals. He regenerates. It's like, you know, a new engine, like generator. He regenerates us so that there's a new strength and there is a new vision, because he reveals the depths, the deep things of God unto us. The Holy Spirit instructs, illuminates, and inspires. He instructs us. The instruction of the Holy Spirit, he illuminates us, he sheds light, he enlightens us, he inspires us. You see, sometimes if you don't have inspiration, your life is dull, your life is weak, your life is like so-so, your life is like lukewarm. But when the Holy Spirit comes in, it's coming to you tonight. He invigorates you, he instructs you, and he illuminates you. He endues with power, he edifies, and he empowers. Maybe there's no power there, and Jesus said, wait in Jerusalem until ye be endued with power from on high. He endues us with power, he edifies us, and he empowers us. Not only that, the Holy Ghost, Holy Spirit intercedes for us. The Holy Spirit interprets the word, and the Holy Spirit invigorates us. You become energized from within, and you are going to have that energy. And then in your community, when you see sinners, there'll be something that prompts you. There'll be something that, you know, kind of inspires you and says, go and join that chariot. And when you go, your word will become like fire in their hearts in Jesus' name. The Holy Spirit guides us. He guides, he gives, and he glorifies. He guides us. He's the one to guide us into all truth. Not only that, he gives everything we need. He gives us gifts. And then he also glorifies Christ in our lives. The Holy Ghost transforms. The Holy Ghost teaches. The Holy Ghost testifies. He says, when he comes, he will testify of me. He will teach you all things. Not only that, he will transform our lives. The Holy Spirit helps us. The Holy Spirit heals us. The Holy Spirit harvests souls into the kingdom. He helps, He heals and he harvests. You see, it's the power of the Holy Spirit that will make us to reach out and the harvest field. When we reach that harvest field, we're going to be successful. I see successful people there. I see productive people there. You'll be productive in Jesus' name. The Holy Ghost sanctifies. The Holy Ghost strengthens. And the Holy Ghost separates. It separates you from the wishy-washy so-called churchgoers and believers. It makes your life different. It makes your life distinct because it sanctifies, because it strengthens, and because it separates. It separates us. Separate unto me, Barnabas and Saul. The Holy Spirit reproves us, refines us, and revives us. It reproves the world of sin. If you're going the wrong direction, it's the Holy Spirit to alert you. The Holy Spirit that will kind of reprove you and say, that is not right. Come back from that. And he refines our lives and he revives us. The Holy Spirit cleanses, controls, and confirms. The Holy Spirit cleanses because by the presence of the Holy Spirit, it drives us to the word of God. He reveals the word of God to us, and that word of God, like water, will wash us, and you'll be clean in Jesus' name. And he controls both the apostle with his companions. They wanted to go here or go there, but the Holy Spirit said no, because he controls their movements. And he confirms us. The word of God will be confirmed in your mouth by the power of the Holy Spirit. And he says, and then let's come back to this John chapter 14. I'm reading from verse 16. It says, and I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another, tell me the name there, Comforter, that he may abide with you forever. It's referred to as Comforter. Look at chapter 15, verse 26. But when the Comforter is come, whom I will send unto you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth, which proceeded from the Father, he shall testify of me. You see there, he calls him again the Comforter. Chapter 14 is Comforter. Chapter 15, he calls him Comforter. Look at chapter 16, verse 7. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send him unto you. He's referred to as the Comforter. And when he comes into your life, comfort will come. You know, there are times we have, some challenges, and some people try to comfort us, but they don't understand, because they cannot reach the very point where we ache. They cannot reach the very point where we are having the problem. And they're like the people that came to Job, and they wanted to comfort him, and they couldn't have any effect on him, and they couldn't really comfort him the way they thought. And Job said, why don't you keep quiet and allow the Lord himself to comfort me. I'm looking at Job chapter 16. I'm reading from verse 1. Then Job answered and said, I have heard many such things. Miserable comforters are ye all. Miserable comforters are ye all. Shall vain words have an end? And what emboldeneth thee that thou answerest? I also could speak as ye do. If your soul were in my soul's stead, I could heap up words against you and shake my head at you. But I will strengthen you if I were with my mouth, and the moving of my lips should assuage and should assuage your grief. But you see that they were not able to really comfort him. But the Holy Ghost, when he comes, he'll comfort you. I said he'll comfort you. Actually, Jesus Christ had this experience. Look at Psalm 69, I'm reading from verse 20. Psalm 69, we're looking at verse 20. Reproach has broken my heart. I am full of heaviness. And I looked for some to take pity, but there was none. For comforters, but I found none. They gave me also gall for my meat, and in my thirst, they gave me vinegar to drink. That was the experience of the Lord Jesus Christ. You see, all the disciples were around. He even said, come with me and pray with me for an hour. But they were all sleeping. And Jesus came and said, what, Simon, could you not watch with me for 1 hour? All those disciples at his hour of trial and the hour of betrayal, they couldn't comfort him. And then the unbelievers, they gave him gold to drink and they gave him vinegar. But the Holy Ghost comforted him. That is why he was telling his own disciples, you'll come to the situation in your life when you need comfort, and the people of this world, whatever they do, they'll try to comfort you. They'll not be able to do that, but the Holy Ghost will comfort you. I said the Holy Ghost will comfort you. And then he tells us it's the Spirit of truth. Is the Spirit of truth and the Spirit of revelation. Come to 1 Corinthians chapter 2. 1 Corinthians chapter 2. I'm reading from verse 11. In 1 Corinthians chapter 2, reading from verse 11, it tells us, it says, for what man knoweth the things of a man, save the spirit of man which is in him? Even so, the things of God knoweth no man, but the Spirit of God. And it says, and we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given unto us of God. That's what he does in our lives. When he comes to us, he makes us to know the things that are freely given unto us of God. He'll reveal more to you today. He'll reveal himself to you. He'll reveal his power unto you. And the greater one will live in you in Jesus' name. We're looking at 1 Peter chapter 4. 1 Peter chapter 4. When you're going through trial, when you're going through some persecution, when you're going under some pressure, and when you need comfort, when you need power, when you need revelation from heaven that will make you victorious in that situation, that's the ministry of the Holy Ghost. He'll come to you. He'll be the comforter, he'll be the power in your life in Jesus' name. We're coming to 1 Peter chapter 4. I'm reading from verse 14. If ye be reproached for the name of Christ, happy are ye. Happy are ye. Your happiness will increase. Your joy will increase. You know, there are some people, when they are under some persecution, or they are under some assault, or they are under some, you know, pressure, they cannot rejoice. You know, their shoulders are down, their face down, and the whole life is like, you know, I'm undergoing some, it's like heaven is falling upon them. It's like they are the only person having problems in the world. But it says when the Holy Ghost comes, it will cheer you up. It will lift you up. And then it says, look at that. If you be reproached for the name of Christ, happy are ye, for the Spirit of glory. Tell me, what kind of spirit? The Spirit of glory. Say it aloud. For the Spirit of glory and of God resteth upon you. On their part is evil spoken of, but on your part is glorified. He'll be glorified in your life. Look at 1 John chapter 4. I'm reading from verse 4. 1 John chapter 4, reading from verse 4. Ye of God, little children, if you are born again, ye of God, little children, if you are saved, ye of God, little children, if you have repented and you are following after the Lord, ye of God, little children, if you love the Lord and you keep his commandments by the grace of God, it says, ye of God, little children, and have overcome them. Are they overcomers here today? Yes. I said that the overcomers here today, you keep on overcoming in Jesus' name. Yes. Because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. I thought I'd hear an amen. Yes. They are of the world, therefore speak they of the world, and the world heareth them. We are of God. I am of God. I'm born again. I am of God. I've repented. I am of God. I'm believing the Lord. I am of God. I'm following the footsteps of the Master. I cannot hear the people again. You're following the footsteps of the Master. You are of God. We are of God. He that knoweth God heareth us. He that is not of God heareth us not. Hereby know we the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. You will not follow the spirit of error.
Yeah.
The spirit of truth, he'll abide with you. He will dwell in you. He will energize you. He will empower you. He'll make you victorious. You'll be of God every time in Jesus' name. Now coming back to John chapter 14. John chapter 14. I'm reading from verse 26. John chapter 14. We're looking at verse 26. Point number 3. The characterization of the Spirit as teacher. The characterization of the Spirit as teacher. In John chapter 14 verse 26. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things. Underline that here, Bible. He shall teach you all things. He shall teach you how many things? All things. You see, there are people, we're not attacking anybody, we're not speaking against anybody, but you know, there are people who say we are Pentecostals. They speak in tongues almost every time. They turn here, speaking in tongues. Turn there, speaking in tongues. Before they sing, speaking in tongues. While they are praying, speaking in tongues. Over the microphone, speaking in tongues. But they're ignorant of the doctrines of Christ. They're ignorant of the things that the Lord has laid down. They cannot even interpret the word of God aright. Plain scripture. They model them up, and yet they claim to have the spirit of truth. It says, Jesus said, if you claim to have the spirit of truth, it says, he shall teach them all things. Not only that, number 2, and bring how many things? All things to real remembrance. There are people, they read the word of God, they forget. And they say, I have the Holy Ghost, I have the Holy Ghost. Let me prove it to you. Let me talk in tongues for you to know that I have the Holy Ghost. Don't talk in tongues for me. Do you remember the word he has spoken unto us? Do you remember the doctrines, the teaching he has given us? When you come to the time of temptation, the time of trial, do you remember the word he has spoken? If the Holy Spirit is there, you know what he will do? Number 1, he'll teach us all things. Number 2, he will bring all things to our remembrance. Number 3, whatsoever I have said unto you. Let's look at that one by one. He shall teach you all things. So we're looking at Matthew chapter 10, and we're reading from verse 20. Matthew chapter 10, and we're reading from verse 20. When the Holy Ghost comes, thank God, is going to come in a greater measure unto you. I said it will come in a greater measure unto you. See what it will do. It says in Matthew chapter 10, I'm reading here from verse 20. For it is not ye that speak, but the Spirit of your Father which speaketh in you. He will speak through you in Jesus' name. Luke chapter 12, I'm reading from verse 12. Luke chapter 12, and we're reading from verse 12. The ministry of the Holy Spirit in the life of a person who is indwelt by the Holy Spirit, saturated by the Holy Spirit. Look at Luke chapter 12, verse 12. For the Holy Ghost shall teach you in that same hour what ye ought to say. The Holy Ghost will teach you in that same hour, teach you all things in that same hour what ye ought to say. We're looking at Acts of the Apostles chapter 4. Acts of the Apostles chapter 4, and I'm reading from verse 7. Acts of the Apostles chapter 4, and we're reading from verse 7. Look at verse 7. In verse 7 it says, Acts chapter 4, and when they had set them in the midst, they asked, by what power and by what name have ye done this? Then Peter, filled with the Holy Ghost, said unto them. Peter, being filled with the Holy Ghost, you see, they asked him a question, and they confronted him, and they wanted to say, who gave you authority to do this? By what name have you done this? By what power have you done this? Then the Holy Ghost came. At such an hour, the Holy Ghost will come to you. Then Peter, filled with the Holy Ghost, said unto them, ye rulers and of the people and elders of Israel, if we this day be examined of the good deed done to this impotent man, by what means he is made whole, be it known unto you all and to all the people of Israel, but that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom ye crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him does this man stand here before you whole. This is the stone, is quoting from the Psalms now. That psalm just came to him, that verse came to him by the Holy Ghost. This is the stone which was set at naught of you builders, which has become the hedge of the corner. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Now, when you saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were unlearned and ignorant men, they marveled. Your life will make them marvel. Amen. Because he will teach you all things, and what he teaches will bring out in such a confident way. And then they took knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus. Somebody here tonight? Are you there? As you go out, when people see you like this and they see the word of God shining forth through you, they'll take knowledge of you. Where is he there? Where is she there? Anywhere you go, the boldness of the Spirit will be upon your life in Jesus' name. You will not be like you were yesterday. You will not be like you were last week. Things are going to become different. I'm so happy I see an army of conquerors, army of champions, army of people that will come back and say, Pastor, I have a testimony. Somebody there, I have a testimony. It will happen in Jesus' name. Come back to John chapter 14, and I'm reading from verse 26. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, number one, he shall teach you all things. Number two, tell me, and bring all things to your remembrance. Bring all things to your remembrance. You see, that's the secret. If you're going to, even if you've made a mistake, there are people that they make a mistake and then they've heard the word of God before, they have been taught before, they cannot remember the things they learned before that will jolt them. The things they had before that will stir them up and say, hey, wait a minute, is that not a mistake? Is that not an error? Is that not falsehood? Should I be like that? The Holy Ghost is not there to remind them. I want you to look at Matthew chapter 26, remembrance. And this is a secret of the victorious life, is a secret of restoration. Even when you've gone astray, when you remember, look at Matthew chapter 26, verse 75. And Peter remembered the words of Jesus. You see, there are people, they go astray, they do something wrong, they say something wrong, and they just keep on saying the same thing. That is wrong, that is dumb. And there's no remembrance. But when the Holy Ghost comes, he will alert you. He'll wake you up. He'll make you remember. And Peter remembered the word of Jesus, which said unto him, before the cock crow, thou shalt deny me thrice. And he went out and wept bitterly. That's what brought the restoration, because he remembered. I want you to look at John chapter 2, verse 22. John chapter 2, verse 22. He'll bring to your remembrance. He'll bring to your remembrance. The word of God you heard before, he brings to remembrance. At a crossroad, he brings to remembrance. When there's temptation, he brings to remembrance. When there's any challenge, he brings to remembrance. In your family, he'll bring the word of God back to remembrance. In your market, he'll bring the word of God back to remembrance. And in your dealings, interaction with your brother, with your sister, he'll bring the word of God to remembrance. When somebody wants to get you into a promise, into a covenant, into an agreement, and the Spirit of God knows that that is not right, and the Word of God says it's not right, it's the Spirit of God that will come to you and bring the Word of God to your remembrance, and then you'll pull away from that situation, because the ministry of the Spirit of Truth is working in your life, bringing the Word unto remembrance. Chapter 2 of John, John chapter 2, verse 22. After these days came John chapter 2, John chapter 2, reading from verse, tell me your verse. Verse 22, when therefore he was risen from the dead, his disciples remembered. His disciples remembered. You see, there are people, they don't remember anything. Whatever they learned last week, that's gone. Whatever they heard last Sunday, that's gone. Whatever victory they had the other time, the promise they had the other time, that's gone. But, and because of that, their lives are empty. Their lives are shallow. But when the Spirit of God is there, and you are remembering every time, that's what will pull you over and give you victory and make you a sustained champion. When therefore he was risen from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this unto them, and they believed the scripture and the words which Jesus had said. The words which Jesus had said. Chapter 12 of John. John chapter 12. I'm reading from verse 16. John chapter 12. I'm reading here from verse 16. In verse 16 of John chapter 12. Here is what it says. It says, these things understood not his disciples at the first, but when Jesus was glorified, then remembered they. He was glorified, and now they had the Holy Ghost at the time after he was glorified, and they remembered that these things were written of him, that they had done these things unto him. I pray that at the critical hour, at the critical time, the Lord will make necessary revelation unto you by his Spirit in Jesus' name. Amen. Acts of the Apostles, Acts of the Apostles chapter 11, Acts of the Apostles chapter 11, we're reading from verse 16. Acts of the Apostles chapter 11, reading from verse 16. Then remembered I the word of the Lord. You see that? Here was his situation now. He was in the house of Cornelius. And as was there, something happened that those people were baptized in the Holy Ghost. And he had been saying before, not so, Lord, not so, Lord, not so, Lord. But now something happens. And all of a sudden, the Spirit of God reminded him. That's what the Spirit of God is to do. In every situation of your life, then remembered I the word of the Lord, how that he said, John indeed baptized with water, but he shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost. With the Holy Ghost, he shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost. We're coming back to John. We're coming back to John chapter 14. John chapter 14. I'm reading from verse 26. John chapter 14, verse 26. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things. He shall teach you all things. You'll not be ignorant anymore. You'll not be empty anymore. You'll fill your heart with knowledge. And he shall bring all things to your remembrance. Look at this now. Whatsoever, whatsoever, whatsoever I have said unto you. Whatsoever I have said unto you. You remember the word of God. The word of promise. The word of power. The word that will make you victorious, the Holy Ghost will bring to your remembrance in Jesus' name. Deuteronomy chapter 12, verse 32. Deuteronomy chapter 12, verse 32. Whatsoever. Deuteronomy chapter 12, verse 32. What things soever I command you, observe to do it. What if you don't remember? How will you do it? What if it doesn't come back to your mind? Are you going to do it? What if you hear and forget? The commandment is there, you forget. But if the Holy Ghost brings it back, your life will be a dynamic life. What things soever I command you, observe to do it, thou shalt not add thereto, nor diminish from it. Jeremiah chapter 42. Jeremiah chapter 42. Whatsoever he has commanded, that's what is bringing to your remembrance. Jeremiah chapter 42, reading from verse 4. Jeremiah chapter 42 from verse 4. Then Jeremiah the prophet said unto them, I have heard you. Behold, I will pray unto the Lord your God according to your words, and it shall come to pass whatsoever sinner the Lord shall answer you, I will declare it unto you, I will keep nothing back from you. He was a prophet, he was a preacher. You know, if you're a preacher, you don't have the Spirit of God to remind you. You want to, you know, maybe preach the word of God. You want to encourage people in the word of God. You remember there is a verse somewhere. It says, talk in there, but I'm trying to look for it. And then you're searching. You cannot remember. Are you going to be an effective minister? But here Jeremiah said, I'm going to go to the Lord in prayer for you. And whatsoever thing the Lord will say, whatever he says of his promise, whatever he says of his warning, whatever he says of his pronouncement, whatever he says of his commandment, whatever he says of the prophecy, whatever he says concerning you, whatever he says he wants you to do, whatever he says in what direction he wants you to go, I will come and tell you, declare it unto you, I will keep nothing back from you. I pray that this Holy Ghost that always remind us as preachers, remind us of the word of God, all that Christ has taught us, that we need to teach the people of God, he will remind us. He will put everything in our heart and will declare it without fear, without favor, in Jesus' name. Acts chapter 3, verse 22. Acts chapter 3, we're looking at verse 22. For Moses truly said unto the fathers, a prophet, referring to Christ, the Messiah, the one to come, a prophet shall the Lord your God raise up unto you of your brethren, like unto me. Him shall ye hear in how many things? Him shall ye hear in how many things? Him shall ye hear, tell me out aloud. In all things, look at this, whatsoever he shall say unto you. That's what the Lord is reminding us of. As the Holy Ghost comes to us in the full measure, as the Holy Ghost comes to us in the baptismal measure, as the Holy Ghost comes to us and he resides inside us, and we reside inside him, and we're immersed in him, and we're saturated with him, and he refreshes us and renews us, he says, whatsoever he has said unto us, we will remember. And when we remember, we'll declare. When we remember, we will do. When we remember, we will teach. When we remember, we'll emphasize in Jesus' name. Revelation chapter 22, I'm reading from verse 14. Whatsoever. Revelation chapter 2, verse 14. Blessed are they that do his commandments. You are blessed. I said you are blessed. You keep on doing the commandments of God in Jesus' name. Blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city. For without, outside are the dogs, the sorcerers, the whoremongers, the murderers, the idolaters, and whosoever loveth and maketh a lie. I, Jesus, have sent mine angel to testify unto you these things in the churches. I am the root and the offspring of David, the bright and the morning star. And the spirit and the bride say, come. Today you can come. Salvation is available, come. Sanctification available, come. Power available, come. The comforter is waiting for you. The comforter will go home with you. Come, and let him that heareth say, come. And let him that thirst come. And whosoever will, let him take of the water of life freely. I testify unto every man that heareth the words of the prophecy of this book, if any man shall add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book. I pray you'll not be guilty of that. You will not add tradition. You will not add personal opinion. You will not add all the tribal ideas to the word of God in Jesus' name. For I testify unto every man that heareth the words of the prophecy of this book, if any man shall add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book. Verse 19, and if any man shall take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life and out of the holy city and from the things which are written in this book. I pray God will not remove your name. Out of the book of life in Jesus' name. And then from the inheritance of the people of God, God will not remove you in Jesus' name. Don't remove anything from the word of God. Keep it as it is. He which testified these things saith, surely I come quickly. Amen. Even so, come Lord Jesus. And the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. The grace of God will go with you.
Amen.
The peace of God will go with you.
Amen.
The truth of God will go with you.
Amen.
The comforter will go with you.
Amen.
Rise up and receive the blessing of God. Rise up and receive the blessing of God. He's given us much. He's taught us much. He's revealed much unto us. And the Lord is saying, get blessed, get blessed, get blessed. Be immersed in the blessings of God before you go home.